Okay, hot take time. I love the MCU.
Stay on.
Now, I know that's a very controversial opinion to hold, and in doing so, I am very bold and braver than all of the troops. I like how, despite its length and breadth, the MCU remains pretty accessible. The serialization of entertainment has been around for a very long time. Arthur Conan Doyle's first Sherlock Holmes story, A Study in Scarlet, was published in the Strand magazine in 1981. I knew that. I was reading. Which initially kicked off the Sherlockiverse, which contains but is not limited to the Sherlock Cinematic Universe, the Sherlock Legends collection that no one's quite sure is canon or not, and the Batman vs Superman of Sherlock interpretations, BBC Sherlock.
No, no, Mr. Pyrick, not at all. Hanged? Yes.
My point is, multiple stories built around one continuity are nothing new. And being able to drop in on the latest chapter in the adventures of the Ironest Man and Captain Punches, and still usually get a complete experience, is pretty central to the appeal of Marvel, and what helps them gross all of the money in the world. I was at my girlfriend's grandparents' house not long ago, and her family all go to the cinema at least once a week. Her grandfather brought up, I'm gonna do a Wigan accent. That movie, what were it? Avengers Infinity. That were good, wasn't it? He's talking about a movie where a buff purple alien gets six rocks of space crack and then wipes out half the universe. On the way to do that, he fights a man in a robot suit, a wizard, a Spider-Man, a tree, raccoon. He meets a Hugo Weaving impersonator on a strange planet that gets him to kill his daughter, even though she's green and he's purple. And on paper, that sounds really disjointed, but even this lovely old fella from Wigan could follow that and think, yeah, it's pretty good. And he probably hasn't seen the 8 million Marvel movies that have already come out. So if I quizzed him on why Tony was apprehensive about calling his bearded lesbian life partner, or what any of the six stones did, he'd probably tell me to leave his house and never return. Marvel have achieved something weird and wonderful by creating their own pocket of pop culture, where anyone can see the angry raccoon and think, this is fine. And I think that's pretty magical. However, there is one thing Marvel has fostered that displeases me greatly. The Marvel news cycle has grown to become even more powerful than Thanos himself. It's an all-encompassing sub-community of the fans that's only partly Marvel's fault. Communities have formed around dissecting every trailer, tweet by a director, every interview with Kevin Feige, and every time an actor posts a picture on Instagram. And honestly, I think it's kinda nice that any time an actor says anything, or posts a picture to Instagram, it's treated as the final piece of the puzzle that makes the entire universe make sense suddenly. Like, we'll see Gwyneth Paltrow post a picture like this, and suddenly we know that she took a break from conning upper-class white women by putting various kinds of crystals inside the vaginas, and she's gonna get her robot suit, and she's gonna go save Tony. She's gonna sacrifice herself and her baby, and she's gonna give Tony the suit, and he's gonna fly back to Earth, and they're gonna beat Thanos with the power of vagina crystals. Maybe they're the Infinity Stones, oh my gosh. Like I said, this is mostly fan speculation, which I can't rail on because, hey, we all do it. But see, a lot of column writers and YouTubers are also fans, and they rely on this speculation to make a living. And that's what I mean when I say it's not exactly Marvel's fault. They could probably fire their entire marketing team at this point, and it would have minimal effect, because of how feverish their word of mouth gets. The Marvel news cycle, this is a trademark term that I invented, definitely, comes in a few stages. Stage 1 actually starts partway into the process, because there is never not Marvel news. So stage 1 is rumination on past news. Did we hear about Hawkeye becoming Ronin first, or did we hear that the title definitely wasn't Endgame first? We don't remember. All we remember is that 13 different YouTubers did 10-minute analyses of the news and how it fits into their theories. Stage 2 is that we get some new, fairly inconsequential news. A casting announcement, say, that an older Cassie Lang will appear in the movie. This causes a whole new wave of speculation. Cassie is now the Wasp in the new Avengers team post-Endgame. The time skip creates an Interstellar-esque story where Scott returns to a much older and more resentful Cassie who feels she's been abandoned. Scott, trapped in the quantum realm, approaches a vortex and is spat out into an alternative universe where everyone is just bigger for some reason, and he, Scott, becomes Ant-Man sans his suit, for he is much smaller than his avenging pals. Step 3 is the merging of new news and old news. We heard that the characters in Infinity War who were underutilized are gonna get top billing in Endgame. So you think, well, Ant-Man wasn't even in Infinity War, so he must be the MVP in Endgame. And wait, I remember those shots of him back in time in the Battle of New York, so he must go back in time, but his daughter is older? It's a time travel movie, I guess? And this goes on. Bear in mind, each of these steps brings with them their own 10-minute analysis videos, their own features and editorials on major publications, as well as the ones you'd expect them from. Step four is to go back to step one. Do not pass go, do not collect $200. This is the part of the video where I was going to bring up news and media theories related to things like agenda setting and news values. But it's been a while since I studied any of that. So I did a Google search for news theories and I found this. The key was the truck all along. How could I have been so foolish? Of course, Thanos' one true weakness is being yeeted by a truck. And honestly, it kind of upsets me because, I mean, clickbait is just a part of life now, and I accept that. But for every 5-10 things you missed videos, there's maybe one unique piece of information that one person has that the others don't. It's one thing you missed and 9 things you saw with your eyes, because it's not exactly deep-coded subtext. It's a van, and it's right fucking there. And okay, some of these channels are amazing. I think Mr. Sunday Movies is one of the best channels on YouTube. I love his podcast. Charlie at Emergency Awesome is cool, even though he's one of the perpetrators of this insert whatever talking point is popular at the moment and how it relates to X for the newest Avengers movie. But I genuinely think some of these channels work out of love for the comics and movies. It's just a little bit frustrating when these films that, granted, have a habit of throwing in details that are either obvious connections or so obscure that it's only possible to get them by watching these kinds of videos, are treated as tantamount in understanding this conjoined narrative, as if it enhances the storytelling in any meaningful way. And again, I love the MCU so much. I think they've created, in most cases, the definitive version of these characters, like Captain America and Iron Man. Barring the first two Avengers movies and the weirdening of the characters, they've remained pretty consistent in dialogue and action. So, okay, here's a bit of a tangent. The first Avengers movie has this line by Captain America.
Guys come from legend, they're basically gods.
There's only one god, man. And I'm pretty sure he doesn't dress like that.
Like, what does this mean? Is Steve Rogers religious? He might be in the comics sometimes, and he might be in the movies too. But this is Steve Rogers, who is chosen for the Super Soldier Project for his bravery, strong moral compass, and determination to do the right thing. Was he molded this way by religious doctrine? Like, there's no problem if he was. I think making Captain America a paladin is pretty sweet, but I feel like it would have come up by now. Compare that to one of my favorite Steve Rogers moments in the entire MCU.
Eyes up. Stay sharp.
That's just a handful of words and some very stoic acting that convey more character in Steve in these few seconds than his entire meme show in The Avengers Assemble. He's stretching up before he runs headfirst into a brick wall slash shithouse. He knows he's gonna lose, but he's gonna get in some good hits on the way down. Absolutely brilliant. Stand up, lad.
So to summarize, it's okay to not know every tiny thing about the movie before you go into it. You don't need to know the relevance of Tony's fucking space tank top and where it came from, because that's not important. Because you know what? Tony's tank top isn't going to defeat Thanos, is it? So just watch the bloody movie, pal. Just watch it.